welcome to Queen Anne's County's Board of Education meeting that I have. May I have a motion to go into closed session?
So moved.
Oh,
you have to.
Annette.
As permitted by the Section 3-305B of the General Provisions Article of the Anecdotic Code of Maryland, I move that we go into closed session to discuss a personnel matter that affects one or more specific individuals, to review the personnel and transportation reports, to discuss collective bargaining, and to review meeting minutes from December 14th and December 21st.
A second.
Okay, she second. I have a motion and a second. Any comments or questions? Hearing none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it. We'll see you back here at 6 o'clock p.m. Thank you.
Welcome to the Board of Education meeting. This is a public meeting that is being videotaped for county citizens to review on QACTV7, a local cable station. The agenda is available on the information table. During this meeting, we ask that you turn off your cell phones and or pagers and hold personal conversations and comments outside the meeting room. We will now stand and be led in the Pledge of Allegiance by Board President Bishop Arlene Taylor.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I would like to have a motion to accept the agenda and the minutes from December the 14th and 21st.
At this time, I'd like to make a motion to amend the agenda by removing the military policy pending a presentation in February on cost alternatives for retroactive pay.
I would like to make a motion to accept the agenda as amended.
No, we have to vote.
I second that amendment.
Thank you. Now I have to do.
I accept. Now I need a motion to accept the agenda as amended.
No.
Okay. Okay. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Have a second. Hearing. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? The ayes have it. Any comments or questions? Hearing none, we accept the agenda as amended. Next, we have on our agenda.
Arlene, I need to make a motion to accept the agenda as amended.
I second that motion.
No, this is the second one.
Okay. Okay, we have exception at first and a second. Do I have any comments or concerns? All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? The ayes have it. The agenda has been accepted and amended. Mm-hmm. And next we'll have approval for the minutes from December the 14th and this December the 21st.
So moved.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Okay, I'm hearing a motion to have a second. Is there any comments or questions? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? No. The ayes have it. And next we'll have our recognition by Mr. Greg Paluski.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening.
Tonight, we'd like to express our appreciation and thanks for the efforts of our talented staff and our talented students. The Hero Award. The Queen Anne's County Public Schools Hero Award is sponsored by our friends at Six Flags Theme Park, including two complimentary tickets to Six Flags, along with the Anti-Bullying Committee and Character Counts. This month's Hero Award will be given to Riley Korn, a fourth grader at Bayside Elementary School. Where's Riley? Riley, come on up. Congratulations. I got some cool things to say about you. Just stand right here. Miss Riley, Mrs. Willie nominated her for this award because of her exceptional big heart. She is kind to every single person, regardless of his or her personality, academic level, disability, or background. Ms. Willie says, Riley is truly a role model for others for what accept and understand all human beings is all about. This is evident in what Riley says and does every single day. She asks everyone how they are doing every day and is truly concerned about their well-being of others and whether they are their different age, race, or friend group. She goes above and beyond to help, whether it's a student struggling on math or a teacher who needs an extra hand for a minute. She continually takes the initiative to help students with disabilities without being... asked. To everyone, Riley touches them with her heart. She is their hero. Thank you, Riley, on behalf of the Queen Anne's County Public Schools for being our hero at Bayside Elementary School and to continue to make a difference in the lives of your classmates through such a kind heart that you have. Congratulations. Come on, come on with that.
Go ahead, Ms. Willie.
Your siblings?
Ms. Willie.
Yeah. What's waiting to say?
Bring her a sister up. We'll bring everybody up. Congratulations. She'll be very proud of her.
Thank you, sir. Oops, sorry. All right. Smile. One, two, three. Thank you.
Awesome. Tonight we also have a very special recognition. We have a special recognition from Stevensville Middle School this month. Charlotte Zeitlin is an eighth grader. Did I say that right? Zeitlin is an eighth grader who was awarded first place at the middle school level for the State of Maryland and the First Lady of Maryland Art Show. Would you please come forward? First Lady Hogan hosted a special exhibition of students' artwork located in the Lowell House office building. Mrs. Hogan, an artist herself, has made it a priority to install a love of art in Marylanders of all ages through arts education. Charlotte is an amazing artist and a wonderful representation of the Queen Anne's County Public Schools and the visual arts program. Her artwork will be displayed for 6 months at the House of Delegates in Annapolis, followed by a display at the Maryland State Department of Education. Her teacher, Mrs. Schrader, and principal, Mr. Kintop, are so proud of her as we are. Thank you, Charlotte, for your hard work, creativity, dedication in your art class. Your hard work is truly paying off. Congratulations.
All right, one, two, three. Thank you.
In our last special recognition this evening, we'd like to take this chance to recognize the Anti-Bullying and Unity Day Committee. The annual QACPS Unity Day was held in October, and it's all thanks to our amazing sponsors and our Anti-Bullying Committee. We are thankful for the staff and community members who are dedicated to addressing bullying issues in Queen Anne's County and helping find a solution. Unity Day has become one of our biggest community events and through months of hard work. Unity Day was once again a huge success. With Tracy Donahue, Linda Austin, I think Jackie Carter, Leslie Fulham, Sterling Ward, Mary, and Aaron Condon, and Elaine Butler, please come forward.
We got three of
us. Well, wonderful. Please come forward. I would like to thank these ladies for their help in making this day become an event where all of our students in Queen Anne's County can feel that they belong, that they are heard, and they're together as one. Queen Anne's County Public Schools is grateful to have staff and community members like you who help ensure that Queen Anne's County Public Schools is happy, is fair, is kind, and is bully-free learning environment. Thank you for all of your hard work, and we look forward to another successful Unity Day next year.
Sign the public thing.
So we don't have to do it.
No, you have to ask if anybody would like to come forward.
Me too. I just ask?
Yeah.
You have to still read.
I don't have it to read.
I know, there's nothing on there.
I know, but she needs the thing to read at the top.
Thank you.
You think I'm a mind reader and numb?
Sorry.
Point out to where it reads, like where she has to read.
Yep. Huh? It's the same thing.
Right below, right above the printed.
Okay. We ask all speakers to keep in mind, is that what I'm supposed to read? And there's something else I'm supposed to read?
I think it's at the bottom of...
Citizen participation is not intended to be a question and answer session. If you have specific questions, the board will make sure an appropriate staff member responds to your questions at a later date. The board respects your desire and right to convey your message freely, but ask as a courtesy to this board and our citizens that you respect the board's request to refrain from naming citizens and name calling when offering your critique. We have no one signed up, so I guess we move on from there.
We ask if anybody.
You have to ask if anybody in the audience.
Is anyone that's not on this list, would you like to speak? Okay.
Now we can
move on.
Yes, we can. Next we'll have, I just had it, the students report, starting with Ms. Todd. Mm-hmm.
Well, welcome back from break. it was very short. For January, we don't have much going on, just a lot of tests. This is our testing month of this week, and we have some tests next week. We have PARC going on, and HSAs, government, biology, the whole shindig. And then the 20th and 23rd, we have high school as half days, because those are our final days. And then we have off the 24th and 25th, and then 26th, the new marking period starts, which is exciting. And then we just have a lot of sports events happening this month. A lot of basketball. Both our women's and men's team are doing really well. And swimming and wrestling and indoor track. And the only other thing is our musical is still on March 3rd. So make sure that's in your calendar. And we're doing The Sound of Music. And January 13th is the big QA, Kent Island basketball. All of it is at Kent Island. So good luck.
Pop that one.
Well, similar with Paige, we have a bunch of testing this month. On January 3rd, that passed, 4th, that was today, and then on the 5th, we have our English 10 classes doing the PARC assessment. On Friday, January 6th, Mr. Schreckengoss and all the students of Ken Island High School are excited for the first snow day of the school year.
Will it to happen?
Very excited also.
That was Mr. Schreckengoss's idea, by the way. He's going to watch us and see that I called him out.
I'll call him after this.
We have our HSA assessments as well. On January 9th, we have the government HSA, and on the 10th, we have the biology HSA. On Friday 13th, we have, like Paige mentioned, the QA versus KI game for boys and girls. And just to say, we have home field advantage, so. Except we don't really need an advantage.
Do you guys sit together at these games?
No, we're yelling at each other from across the room. On Friday, January 20th and January 23rd, we have final exams and early dismissal. On Thursday, January 26th, we have the first semester is wrapped up, so then the second semester starts. And on January 30th, we have rising ninth grade scheduling night, where all the ninth graders future ninth graders come in, and then they get to see which classes they'd like to attend when they come to high school. And that's all for me.
Okay, thank you, ladies, so much. Next, we'll move down to our presentations, the suspension data from Mr. Brad Engel. Very nice, sir. And then I guess he can continue on with the multicultural education equity.
So as Mr. Engel is preparing, one of our goals this year has been to look at our strategic plan and present on our strategic plan to the board. If you remember, Mr. Brown did goal one, which is our academic indicators, and then this evening Mr. Engel is going to be presenting on strategic goal two, which is our safe and supportive learning environment goal. So just know that this is a culmination of reviewing our strategic plan as we go through the year.
Switch chairs.
And is joined by Ms. Pauls.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So I'm going to give a brief presentation on our discipline data for the past school year. And this is data that comes from the Maryland State Department of Education. And this is something that I take a look at probably every day. I look at our data and I look at our numbers. And when there's an incidents going on at school, I'm made aware of just about every one of them. And so I take a great personal interest in our discipline data, because there are numbers on the screen, but there's a story behind each number, and there's a child behind each incident. So, the purpose is to share the suspension data from last year and to talk about what we're doing to address some of the issues that I'll bring up, because the data clearly shows there are some things that we need to address, that we have been addressing and will continue to address. All students in Queen Anne's County will attend school in a safe and supportive school climate. That's our vision. We want parents to feel like when they send their children to our schools that they're sending them to a safe environment, not just physically safe, we know how important that is, but we want them to feel emotionally safe as well. And we feel that that's very important. And so you can see the objectives. We'll talk about some of the types of suspensions, share them by subgroup, and talk about the different levels, we'll share data by levels, and we'll talk about some of our school climate initiatives and talk about some alternatives to suspensions as well. So there are the numbers there. You can see that last year there were 202 suspensions, out-of-school suspensions, as recorded by the Maryland State Department of Education, and I know some of you got this information, have seen this already. But some things are pretty clear and pretty obvious. First of all, you can see that the number of males suspended, out of the 202 suspensions, 179 suspensions were boys, males. I don't know if you're surprised or not. on a serious note, you are the number one type of incident disposition that receives a suspension were physical attacks. And to us, that's an issue. We had 90 physical attacks in our school last year. And 81 were boys. And so I think that we have to work with our boys on, this is not how you solve problems, by getting into a physical conflict. There are other ways to resolve issues. And so looking back at some of the narratives of some of the data, a lot of these fights started on social media. People going back and forth, mm-hmm. kids going back and forth, and then the next day things erupt. And time after time I hear about incidents in schools with kids who are, hearing things and, or they're hearing about rumors online, or they're sharing things that that the next day they kind of heat up in the school environment, and then all of a sudden you've got a fight or a physical attack. That's a concern.
Strangle. Do these numbers include incidents at like after school activities as well, or is it only during a certain school hours?
Yeah, during the instructional day or school activity. It could be a dance. Something occurs at homecoming, certainly that would be in there. It could be a field trip.
Okay.
Yes, absolutely. On the bus, yes. On the way to and from school, absolutely. That's a good question. Yeah, thanks for asking that. I just wanted to real quickly touch base that, as you can see, some areas of concern, certainly with the drugs, and that's drugs and alcohol. We had 26 incidents last year, and that's something that, I've talked about before, and something that we're addressing in a lot of ways. But there are some very serious issues, as you can see by this data. One thing I did want to mention is that on the far right, that column is disrespect. It's disruption, disrespect is what the coding is. So these are offenses where the child was disrespectful or disruptive in the classroom, in the hallway, in the school environment, causing some kind of disruption. So 74 students were suspended.
Mr. Engel, what were the weapons? Where it says all and then it has weapons.
Yeah, they were all incidents of students bringing a knife to school. And a lot of times they were in their backpack. Without getting into too much detail, a couple times they were brought by accident. They were out, doing activities with their family. They happened to have it in their backpack. None of these incidents, students, when they brought weapons, had brought them with the intent of harming anybody.
Okay.
So they just had them. I mean, one had stolen one from his brother and just, wanted to bring it.
Right.
So, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry. And you can see, and then it's broken down by the elementary level. There were 17 suspensions, 16 out of 17 were males. So, I guess that trend starts young. And so you can see those numbers as well. I mean, fortunately, we don't have a lot of suspensions at the elementary level. Okay. And then the middle school, there's an increase in the number of suspensions, the same kind of trends. The physical attacks seem to increase and the fights and the, middle school's a tough age. I understand that. And you have probably close to half of the suspensions at the middle school level were for disrespect or insubordination, again. So that's something, another area that we try to address with school climate. And I know Mr. Paluski and Ms. Pauls have said many times it's all about building relationships with students and emphasizing that relationship, because I think that if you have a relationship with a student, it's going to, they're going to be less likely to disrespect you.
I think a lot of it we're addressing through professional development as well, and looking at bias and ethnicities and cultures. Through our training, we're finding out that sometimes we don't understand different cultures. And when we address those issues with teachers, then we have a better understanding. Also, what does disrespect look like in one school and what it looks like in another school may differ. So we're looking at some consistency with what exactly is disrespectful and should warrant an office referral.
We go back to the overall. Yep, that's it. So, and to piggyback on what Ms. Pauls has said, I wanted to look at the disproportionate number of suspensions. As you can see, if you look at the subgroups of the 202 suspensions, you can see that 47 black and 11 two or more races, 57 students with disabilities, and that's higher than...
What is students with disabilities? I mean, is that...
Students with IEPs. Special education
Special
students.
Okay.
Yeah, special,
special
education.
Ed students.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And so our disproportionate suspensions for African Americans is 3 times higher than the population. And I mentioned this a couple of years ago when I presented our discipline policy, that this was something that we needed to take a look at and addressed. And in the past 2 years, it has not gotten any better. Even though our suspensions are low, we still have a high number for disproportionate suspensions.
So what we're doing this year to kind of monitor that is when the assistant principals come in for their meetings on a monthly or bi-monthly basis, we have them to bring their data, and we talk about the disparities if we're seeing it in data and how to address it so that we don't wait until the end of the year and say, wow, here we are again, and we've got 50 kids, who are males and African-Americans where we had some issues. So we're really trying to take a look at it in small chunks. So.
So the actual suspension for disrespect, is there a lot of personal opinion on whether they actually get suspended, or do we have pretty strict guidelines on when it's an out-school suspension or it's an in-school suspension? Or,
well, the principals have the, yeah, that's an excellent question. Principals have the latitude to suspend. And so if they feel an issue, an incident has risen to the level of suspension, then they have the authority to suspend. And that is exactly, you make a very good point, because when you talk about disrespect, the MSDE calls these offenses soft offenses, meaning that it's not drugs, weapons, fighting, physical violence. These are offenses that there may be some subjectivity involved. And so it's up to the, these are discretionary offenses. It's up to the discretion of the principal. So certainly it would be the interpretation of the administrator handling the disposition to make that decision whether that student should be suspended out of school or not. I mean, in my opinion, it's a huge deal when a child gets suspended. You are removing him from an instructional program.
And what the data doesn't show us is what other factors were coupled with the suspension. You know, was it the fifth time for the student that had been referred for disrespect and things of that nature, which we don't really know here, but we're really trying to monitor that more closely so we don't get to the larger numbers at the end of the year. But the principals do have the...
I think the principals need to have that discretion. They know the students, they know, like you said, that recurring or what if you don't get them out of the school, something really awful is going to happen kind of situation. I mean, but what you're talking about, talking it over for professional development, what kind of, is it strategies you're looking at, or?
Yeah, and we're going to get to that in the next presentation, because we're really going to, we selected to do this one first because once we look at the data, the next thing we're going to do is talk about how we're attacking some of the issues. So,
I have a question too. So it's only discretionary on the principal's side when it is disrespect, not when it's weapons, not when it's drugs, or am I misunderstanding that?
It is discretionary across the board unless a child brings a firearm to school. However, we have been pretty consistent with weapons and drugs and physical attack that we have been suspending kids for those offenses. We have been, but I always say every incident is different. You have to look at each incident individually and then make your best decision that way. So
are we putting ourselves in a bad position when student A says, I did the same thing as student B did, and he got called on it, and I didn't, or we brought the police in on him, but we didn't on student B?
Well, the thing is that, like Ms. Paul said, you don't know if it was a second or third time that the child has done that.
True. And what else was involved?
Yeah, what else was involved? And certainly, I think that the principals have some, I think the way we've written our discipline policy, I think the principals are pretty happy. I haven't gotten any complaints from any parents in the 3 years that we've had the policy. And it is an excellent question because consistency is very important. Every parent identifies consistency and understands. So that's an excellent point that you make. So,
and whenever someone gets a referral, an administrator gets a referral, kids have due process. Yeah. They investigate it thoroughly. So it's it's almost like going to court. I mean, they really have to go through a lot of procedures. Based on that information, that's the determination that's made regarding the discipline, so.
Thanks.
Just to sort of review some analysis, like I mentioned, the disproportionate suspensions were at a rate of 3-1 for African-American students during the 2015-16 school year. And then the suspension rate for males was 87.5%. And suspensions for disrespect was over 36%. And suspensions for students with disabilities was 29%. So. Some of the things we're doing, and I've shared some of the things before, and we have PBIS in all of our schools. It's a school climate initiative where we try to emphasize positive behavior in kids, because what we tell principals is the more that you do on the front end, the better your kids are going to be behaving. And so if you create, the best way to reduce suspensions is by having a positive school climate where all are respected. Pretty simple. It's easy to say, because but it really is really a simple formula. Creating that positive school climate, that's why we emphasize that so much. And so, of course, our anti-bullying programs, you saw the committee get recognized. They do a great job. We have a lot of community support for the school climate. Cultural proficiency training, Ms. Pauls, if you want to.
Yeah, so this is where we have Camel and Jones, who are consultants who have been coming to Queen Anne's County for several years, more in last year and then again this year. And they are doing a trainer models. Each school has been asked to send at least two representatives from their building. And during that time, we're providing training to the schools on how to deal with different cultures, how to deal with different genders, so that we are more proficient in dealing with students of all students on an equitable basis and being able to support them in the schools.
You've been doing this for a few years?
It started last year with the administrators during the summer, correct? Yep.
Did all of last year?
Yep, yeah. All of last year, okay. And so this year, now it's more school-based. Mm. And the expectation is that schools spend time working with their staffs on this trainer model. And so far it's gone well. Yesterday we had a meeting with elementary and middle school principals, and every principal shared what they're currently doing in their building regarding practices. So it's a lot of ahas, very emotional training, but very well needed and supported.
Can you give us an example of one? I still don't understand what proficiency training model. Can you give an idea of what one of the principals is doing?
So one of the models that we've done is just like getting to know people. So it's an activity where we automatically assume, one of the activities was we automatically assume that someone who was a white male enjoyed a specific sport or a specific type of music. When we took the time to really work through the activity, that was not characteristic of that person at all. So sometimes we make assumptions based on profiles, and that is not indeed what it truly is. So we're really learning how to ask questions, how to listen, and how to engage students in activities so that we understand them more than we had. And I think an example that was given was at the Sunday supper, wherein one of the participants spoke up and said, we always say what, stop saying what, and in certain cultures, we teach our kids not to answer a question that way. So, if we say what, we don't say what we say. We teach them to say,
yes.
Yes. Yeah, we teach them to say yes, not what. So those types of things.
Another thing I want to add is I'll make a connection back to the curriculum audit. So where this ties in is when we go in to start writing and reshaping curriculum, in our instructional delivery, we'll start adding in culturally relevant strategies that will help teachers in educating kids in the diversity that they have within the classroom. So all of this is kind of tied together to really help teachers better understand the kids that they're working with and to be able to not only reach them academically, but to also address you know, some of the discipline issues that, that really are taking place within the classroom, because what we know is that if teachers are well planned and kids are well engaged in the instructional process, there's a less likely that kids will engage in other behavior. So it's all starting to really begin to start tying together. Really, all of this is in response back to the curriculum audit. So.
And then restorative practices is something that we're exploring this year. We've taken a look at it in the past, and it's the idea of working with schools and students to restore relationships. And there are meetings and circles, and there's a toolkit that can be used for this. And we feel like it's very helpful to the schools, and we're, and Ed Modell is taking the lead on this at this point, and we're still putting this together. The last thing is when a student is suspended at the high school level, as you saw, that's where we have most of our suspensions. What we do at Anchor Points Academy, and I know Carrie Mitten shared this when she did her presentation last spring, when a student is suspended from school, instead of sending them home for those 5 days or 10 days, we send them to Anchor Points Academy, because that way they can get their instructional program, they're in school, and we feel that we can help them continue their education. So that's another one of our initiatives. So we are committed to developing safe and supportive school climates for our students and staff in all our schools. And although we have one of the lowest suspension rates in the state, there's still a lot of work to do to address the areas of disproportionate suspensions, substance use, and violent offenses.
Question? I have one more question. Our suspension rate is one of the lowest in the state. Our disproportionate suspension of that, particularly African Americans, I know we have very few African Americans in Queen Anne's County, but how does that rate compare to other counties on a ratio, similar ratio?
It's about even.
About even.
Across the state.
About 3 to 1.
Yeah, at the state level, it's about 3 to 1. I can't tell you county by county, right, but I would imagine it's pretty close. So we're kind of in line with the state average. Should we move on to our next presentation?
Yes, are there any other questions?
Any other questions? I'm sorry, we're yep, just segueing from one presentation
right
to the
next one.
I just have a quick question. I know with the juvenile services, when two different parties have a conflict or confrontation, they have like a mediation with the parents and the kids and try to sit them down and talk through it. Matter of fact, we're dealing with something like that right now, which happened with some racial comments over the holiday, like you said, and then it comes back to the school. It didn't happen in the school, but it's went over into the school and they got into a fight. But are you guys thinking about doing something like that during a mediation?
Well, we have two things. We've had community mediation Upper Shore, who's mm-hmm. willing to get involved, and I think that's the group that works with juvenile services. They're also available for our school system mm-hmm. as well, and that's a great point. And that is certain. We have made this available. We have used community mediation Upper Shore in our schools in the past. Then the restorative practices that we mentioned, that's another tool. That's another piece of that, where you have someone come in and facilitate, and you bring all parties involved because you want to restore the relationship. Mm-hmm. You're right. You don't want to just suspend the kid and say, okay, you're going to come back
and
it's
fixed.
Because it's not
again.
Fixed.
Right.
The problem's still there.
When they come back.
The issue's still there. So yes. Yeah, so there, it has to be in addition to the consequence, we have to do more with that. So, yes, that's exactly what restorative practices is.
Well, that's what we envision that Ed will be doing.
Correct.
Because he is a community liaison. Right. So if there is a community issue, he would be able to go out into the community and maybe one of the churches or community center and be able to meet with those families and the students that are involved. And the restorative practices would be that type of mediation. Of just kind of talking it out is what they do until they come to a resolve.
That's good.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You want to start?
Your pony. Go ahead.
Okay. All right, so I want to say one thing right off the bat. So I got Mr. Paluski here. I just want to embarrass him a little bit because last year, I can remember July of 2015, I think it was one of his first days on the job, one of the first things he said to me was, you know, I'm a big believer in equity and that's going to be a priority with me. And he stuck to it. He did. So it's his leadership that has driven a lot of this. And then Ms. Pauls came back on board. And, you know, I really feel happy and comfortable with everything that's going on. So I needed to say that up front. And so I appreciate it, Mr. Paluski. Thank you for your leadership.
Thank you.
As a board member, that's very nice to hear. Thank you very much.
It's sincere. Okay. So the purpose is to develop a plan to address the equity in the district, establish a task force, of course, a steering committee, close the achievement gap, establish a five-year plan to address inequities, and comply with COMAR, obviously, which says that you have to have this sort of initiative in your school system. So we're going to, again, partner with this presentation.
We work very well together.
Y'all do good, yeah.
We have a good time.
So all students in Queen Anne's County will have equitable access to the programs and services provided in the districts. Obviously, that's our vision, and you know, we mean it. We want it for all kids.
So these are lifted right from the audit report. Mm-hmm. And those were the five areas that we recited in our four areas, and so that's what we're basing all of our work around this year, decreasing those disparities in enrollment of AP and GT, disparities in the staffing patterns, dropout rates of African-American males, and disproportionate disciplinary actions. And so we have very few dropout, period, but most of them are the African-American males. And this is a long definition. We're not going to read it to you, but what I do want to point out specific components of it. Diversity factors include but are not limited to, and I know often we ask the question, well, when we talk about African Americans, are we talking about Hispanics? We're talking about race, ethnicity, region, religion, gender, gender identity, language, socioeconomical status, age, and individuals with disabilities. So it's not just a particular race when we talk about education that is multicultural.
Thank you. That was needed. Thank you.
So the
this is your work.
Okay. So the structure of our education that is multicultural committee, we have a steering committee, and Janet and I are kind of the co-chairs of this steering committee, and we kind of oversee, I guess these other committees and the initiatives going on in the school system, and then of course Ms. Pauls reports to Mr. Paluski and we share information with him. Quite regularly, and also we have Mr. Farley over here who's on the steering committee as well and has been very involved in with these initiatives and getting these things going. But you know, we have the local management board multicultural proficiency committee, and that is a committee that's made up of the local management board, and I serve as the co-chair along with Ms. Mary Walker, and we meet monthly. And that is where the conversations on race, that's where that started at those LMB meetings with the multicultural proficiency subgroup. And one of the things that came out in the 1994 race equity audit, which was over 22 years ago, was that there was a climate of silence in Queen Anne's County, and that people were not talking about race, and there was a distrust. And so one of the things we thought about on this committee was, well, we need to start talking about race. So the first one was last summer, and of course the most recent one we had on education. It's been kind of theme-based, and we feel like these conversations on race have had a huge impact, not just on our school system, but on the entire county as well. So we think they've gone very well. And that's a tribute to the members of the Multicultural Proficiency Committee, mm-hmm. and of course leadership here in the school system as well. So that's been a big piece of that. And we also have, if you want to talk about the task force.
Yeah, we have the same objectives. The objectives that we shared earlier are shared by all of these committees. So the focus group really is more the steering committee, and that's central office-based folks, Brad, Mr. Farley, Christina Schindler, Bridget Hoban, Eric Daniels. So it's representative of the entire county and different facets of positions in the county. And then the task force is actually school-based representatives, and we meet usually on a bi-monthly basis, and that's either a teacher, and many administrators attend those meetings as well. And again, the focus is the same objectives. And then, of course, the local management board. So many of us serve on all three committees and meet as often as we can, but Brad is our constant factor. He's at all of them, and he really keeps things going. So the process to work through a lot of this is, again, all of what we're doing, a lot of what we're doing is driven by the audit findings, because that's areas where we need to show some growth. And then we spend a lot of time looking at data, suspension data, and then we also have used the equity report of 1994. So here's what we do. We have the monthly multicultural meetings to monitor progress. And we have lots of PD, and the PD is listed for you. I'm certainly not going to read it to you, but you can see a lot of it. Some of it's book study. It's done at teacher specialist meetings, principals meetings, assistant principals meetings. So everyone is hearing the same thing, working on the restorative practices. Co-teaching Diane has been brought into the loop with that. She's going to be doing a lot of professional development because of the data that really looked at the special ed students. And we recently had someone in from MSDE to talk to the entire group about transgender education. So those are all of the things that we're doing. We're working, and we anticipate that we'll have great results. We invite each and any one of you, if you're interested in attending any of the meetings and being a part, to Brad will definitely keep you informed and invite you.
Of course. That was it.
Yep. And we certainly want to thank Brad for all of his time as well, too. He's been an integral part of making it all work, and he's the historian, so he really helps us to kind of put it all together and put it into perspective. So.
Okay.
Questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice job,
Mr. Pender. Yep, me already. Now.
See you. Thank you.
Pender is joined by.
I'm sorry.
You go ahead.
I have Margaret Ellen Kalmanovich, who's our supervisor of transportation. With me, and also we have Lieutenant Dwayne Embert from the Queen Anne's County Sheriff's Office, who we work very closely with through a lot of things. This project happens to deal with transportation right now. You're probably asking kind of what are we even aiming for in this project. For about the past 3 years, we have been analyzing what we want to call a red light runner program, or people that are running the red lights when they're activated on our buses. And there is nothing more, I want to say horrifying, sitting there listening to the bus radio and you hear the bus driver say, I just had a red truck run my red lights. And all I can get was, it was a red Chevy and maybe the first two letters of the license plate. The trend, and I'll show you the numbers in a little bit, seems to be it's increasing in our county, and I'll talk about where and possible some solutions that we've looked at and some things that we have done. But it just seems to be a more reoccurring theme, and we have parents that call in quite frequently voicing concerns about it. You know, we do go out and look at bus stops. Hey, are there any hidden obstructions that are blocking the view for the bus, for the people that are coming around a corner? Really looking at those stops. And then also, if you remember at one of our budget meetings, we had a parent come at Sellersville Middle School that spoke in depth about this. And I actually heard that call go from Mr. Kinneman over the bus radio about a tractor trailer running his red lights. So we're really trying to figure out what can we do. And we've really sat down with law enforcement, and I know that we have Lieutenant Embert here from the Sheriff's Department, but we also have worked with Centerville PD and Maryland State Police in trying to address some of these problems. You know, our purpose is to explain how Queen Anne's County Public Schools are looking to implement a school bus stop armed safety camera program. Our objectives, we want to show you, define the need, demonstrate how photo enforcement works, select the provider, define the program roles and responsibilities, and also demonstrate the success of various school systems. Now, just to let you know, we're not looking to bring this out this school year. This is something that we're working on. Hopefully we can roll out at the beginning of next year, school year, because it does, and you'll see in a few minutes, involve law enforcement, involves the court system, it involves the Board of Ed, all working together. And so it's a process that each of us is going to demonstrate here and explain a little bit more. Here's some scary data. Basically, one day in every April, it's a national day where they poll all the school systems across the nation. I picked out Maryland because I just wanted to show how it really pertains to us. In 2013, there was 3,392 reported by 4,927 school bus drivers that ran their red lights. That's just in one day in the state of Maryland, okay? 2014, you had 3,500 reported by 5,131 school bus drivers. In 2015, it did go down a little bit to 2,795. Now, I do not have the number of school bus drivers because that was not listed. They've gone through some transitions at the State Department. Leon Lang was the transportation supervisor, so we didn't have all the information. The scary part about that number is number 83. That's how many passed on the driver's side of the bus, where the students are getting off the bus to go see mom and dad or go home. That's kind of a very alarming to us. We started gathering the data, Margaret Ellen, I should say, started this 3 years ago. And in 2014, we had 67 of our bus drivers had their red lights run. And I wanted you to kind of see what the AM looked like and the PM. So it's more common in the afternoon to occur, but it does still happen in the AM. In 2015-16, that increased to 73 drivers. And in the current year, we're looking so far at 40. So we will easily top 80, 90 for the remainder of, you know, the entire year. So those numbers are trending up. And like I said, it's one or two or three times a week that this is happening. And I'll show you the next slide. These are some areas that law enforcement and in the school system have sat down and taken a look at. And in our first year, it was kind of random. It was kind of all over the place. It was northern Queen Anne's County. It was central. It was Route 8 on Kent Island. The past 2 years, it has predominantly been north of Centerville. Particularly, I identified these four roads, but three of them, Route 213 north of Centerville, basically from Churchill Elementary School up to the Kent County line. That's one of Mr. Kinneman's routes. He has really experienced a lot of people running his red lights. We are fortunate enough through law enforcement, where Lieutenant Embert from his department assigns deputies or state troopers to follow the buses to sometimes catch them. That does work occasionally. Sometimes it doesn't because, you know, they see that police car sitting there. And then sometimes we get phone calls of, hey, I have this state trooper or deputy following my bus, you know, what's going on? And you're kind of like, well, it's for a reason. But 300-302 Dale Walls is another bus that I can remember that was experiencing a lot of problems. So we've identified some areas, you know. Now, what can we do as a school system and also with law enforcement? We've tried the Red Light Runner program. Again, that's tough to do because, hey, if one person does it, next thing you know, that deputy is with that person pulled over on the side of the road, so there's nobody following the bus for the rest of the time. It is a good deterrent, but can we take it one step further? Currently, what a lot of school systems are looking at is basically it's the same light, red light camera that you see across the state of Maryland nation. And We're looking at having these cameras basically installed on not all of our buses, but picking three or four buses. We're not rolling this out. And the first thing I want to tell you is this isn't about making any kind of money off of this. And you'll see the money part here shortly. This is what we're trying to really focus on, you know, is the safety of the students. And talking through with Lieutenant Embert and also the sheriff, they were both eager and kind of working with us to come to some kind of resolution on this issue. So basically what happens, if you look at the diagram, the first little box, the small circle that is identified with the red circle around it, that is the sensor that indicates, hey, somebody just ran the red lights on the bus. The other four little rectangles on the side, those are the cameras that take video or a picture of the vehicle going through there. The final one is in the rear of the bus, which also takes like a whole area shot of what's occurring. And you'll kind of see what law enforcement looks at briefly here in a minute when we go through this. The other option we also have, I told you there was 83 times in the state of Maryland where a car passed on the passenger side where the students get off the bus or get on the bus. And we have had that happen in our county. One of the options we're looking at is selecting a provider. We have been working with ATS, which currently has systems in St. Mary's County and also Washington County. They're also one of the national leaders in the red light camera itself. They have Laurel, Anne Arundel County, Howard County. So they're a large provider. They've been around. They're established. So we're looking at them and a few others, but we just wanted to kind of give you an overview of, you know, we weren't going by a fly-by-night company. So we reached out, Margaret Allen and also Lieutenant Embert, to St. Mary's County and Washington County. Also, Montgomery County does use a system. It's with a different company. There's pluses and negatives to everything. We felt very comfortable with this. Just to show you, St. Mary's County has five camera units installed, okay? They have 199 buses that travel about 4 million miles a year. Washington County has 10 cameras that are on their school buses, and they travel about 3.2 million. We have 88 school buses that transport about 1.9 million, almost 2 million miles. So if you're looking at the proportion of cameras, we're not talking about having 88 cameras. We're talking about having two or three, maybe four. We won't quite have that figured out until we meet with the selected company and all three of us meet. But basically, with any company we select, we're going to have three partners. And we'll have the school district, ourselves, okay, law enforcement. And then the other portion you'll see is dealing with district court. And how are we going to go about, you know, assessing the fines and approving that? And within the next slide or two, Lieutenant Embert is really going to kind of help us out here with this, because it's kind of uncharted territory for Queen Anne's County. Centerville does have red light cameras, or I'm sorry, they have speed cameras in there. So it is something we have, the county has, but we're really trying to work through it to make it a smooth transition with this. Lieutenant Embert, did you want to help discuss how the process works, sir?
Yeah, I can pick it up from the time that a violation has actually been taken, or a photo has been taken of a violation. What would happen, whoever the provider is that we choose would take and send that data, that image you see on the left-hand side, to a representative at the sheriff's office. And the representative at the sheriff's office is going to review that. Some of this done with traffic cams now to make sure that everything in the violation seems to be the way it should be, that, you know, the red lights were activated, that the vehicle definitely went through. And if we approve and say, yes, this does appear to be a violation, then we would take and approve that. That would in turn go back to the company. The company then would take and send the violator a notice that they have been captured on film violating the red lights of the school bus. And then the choice for the violator is they can pay the fine. Well, first thing you can do, they can go to this company's website, which I thought was really good, and look at what happened. They can watch the actual video of their car actually what transpired in regard to the bus, which I think is a huge benefit. Then they can choose to pay the fine, $125, or they can take and choose to say, hey, I want to go to court because there is some other mitigating factors in regards to this. If they choose to go to court, the fine can be up to $250 in court costs. So currently now, if we actually observe someone doing this violation of the red lights, it's a $570 fine. Jeez. But getting back to what Mr. Pender said earlier, you know, we have some grant money that we put officers out there to take and follow buses, but we have to make sure we have to be there at the exact second that the violation occurs, and that's tough. That's very tough. These camera systems, I think, will take and be able to be with the bus at all times on their routes, but these buses have been identified as being in these problem areas. So I have spoken to the district court a little bit, their headquarters. We won't be the first ones in the state, as Mr. Pender has said, going through this process. All we need to do is take and identify our provider and then actually submit what our paperwork is going to look like, and then they will come on board with us.
Margaret Ellen, you've spoken to St. Mary's County and also Washington County, and has it been a pretty seamless transition?
Yes, they what they did with the company was gave them a lot of data, and the data included with the buses how many stops different buses made, along with the information they had gathered, like we've gathered over the past 3 years, as far as what buses were ones or areas that they'd want to target. So they, you know, it was a partnership, and of course, with anything, they've, with the first ones in the county or within the state, they've learned a lot from that to be able to share, you know, with other counties. So it's been beneficial to them. Even though there's so many cameras, they may have those cameras and then change them to different buses, yeah, at different times. If they find that a camera is on a particular bus and nothing, they really don't get that many violations or none at all, then they might switch it off to another bus. So even though there are so many cameras, they are changing them around.
And as
one other thing, when we did meet with this one vendor, the one thing that I thought was a real benefit was we talked about recidivism rates. And the recidivism rates are extremely low. So hopefully this will bring awareness. And, you know, as we said, as Mr. Pender said, it's not a money-making idea. This is to take and stop the problem. And they said it's been very effective in those locations.
Well, when school starts up, you know, Margaret Ellen is out there doing a media campaign, you know, trying to, hey, school's back in session. Here's, you know, red light. We have a meeting with twice a year with law enforcement about the grant. So we're just trying to come up with a different avenue that we can help, you know, solve or lessen some issues that could potentially be devastating. Yes, ma'am.
What does this company, this provider do? They provide the cameras, they ship the cameras. But after law enforcement's done all the work to determine the problem, then why do we hand it to somebody else to issue the citation?
The provider, the company actually provides all the cameras, which is expensive.
Okay. Right.
They install them, they maintain them. These camera systems were really, when they were explaining the camera systems, they even have defrosters in them, so in those cold or foggy mornings, you know, they're high-tech cameras. The only thing, there's very little work that will be done on the part of law enforcement. Basically, the lion's share of this is maintaining installing the cameras. All we're going to do, actually, if you could see that slide better, I think it says it takes law enforcement about 30 seconds to review and to approve a violation. So the time that law enforcement takes is going to be very minimal, very minimal. The work is installing and maintaining these cameras.
Okay, so it's the cameras, it's not the
it's camera, the software, and then also if we want to get to a certain point, they can link it into district court to set up the court schedule with that. So it's basically, you know, hands off for us. It's, you know, freeing up law enforcement for other issues to also address. Now you're asking, okay, what the court or what the cost would be. It's $125 for a citation. Basically the same thing, you know, if you ran a red light or, you know, speeding. The company or any company you select is going to take a percentage of it. All right. And what I just want to be very transparent about this. You know, basically in the first year, the company would get 75%, we get 25%. second year, 60%, 40%. And I wanted to give you a breakdown of, you know, the amount of money you're talking about here. And I did some calculations. If you were just to capture, I mean, 20 times, we're looking at the company after 4 years getting $1,250, us getting $1,250, all right? The money, when they split it, it can go to the sheriff's department, it could go to the Board of Ed. We talked about, the sheriff was very gracious and said, hey, well, why don't we have something where we put it back into school bus safety? What can we do for that? Which I thought, you know, the three of us thought was a great idea after we spoke about that. So, you know, we're looking at it as more as a deterrent. I don't, you know, we're not looking at this as being a huge, you know,
it's not a moneymaker.
Right. Mm-hmm.
This is, it's not a moneymaker, it's the safety of our children.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So,
I have a question.
Go ahead, yes, ma'am.
So, if they get a $125 citation right now without the camera system, that goes, well, they wouldn't without the camera. Well, no, if the bus driver was able to report it fully with a number and the department determined that it happened or witnessed it, would that automatically go to court as a $125 ticket that they could appeal?
No, as I said before, if we were actually to see a violation, the fine is, I believe, is $570 right now, and it's a payable offense. The person who received that citation could pay that.
Okay. If it's witnessed by a law enforcement officer.
That's correct.
Okay. Here,
and the issue is, when we get the reports from the drivers, often they can tell you it was a red truck.
Right.
Very, very seldom they can get a tag number. But the third piece of that, Marilyn, you have to be able to do is identify the driver. Yeah. Bus drivers are more worried about the safety of the kids,
sure,
than they are trying to get that information.
Sure.
And over the years, I've seen where we've actually had enough information to charge based on a driver providing information. I don't really remember of any.
Okay. And that difference between five whatever and 125 is because we're not.
Well, this is a civil violation.
Yes.
The 125. Okay. This is actually when it's issued from a camera, it's deemed a civil violation.
Mm-hmm. Just like, and if they paid it, that wouldn't even go through the court system. It would go through this program.
That's correct. And that's another piece that the vendor does. The law enforcement will not send out a citation in the mail or email to someone. All that's done by the back office of the vendor,
uh-huh,
whichever vendor we happen to choose.
Uh-huh. And what recourse do we have if they just do not pay?
Then they can have to go to court.
Okay.
And there's certain things like registrations could be flagged.
Uh-huh.
Same thing that would happen there with a speed, uh-huh, camera or a red light or,
okay,
traditional red light camera.
Wonderful.
All right. Then in conclusion, as Lieutenant Embert mentioned earlier, the states that I've mentioned, Georgia, Maryland, Virginia, Texas, and Washington, that have instituted a program have seen a 43% decrease in the violations that have occurred. We will continue to work with the Sheriff's Office and also the state's attorney district court to kind of fine-tune some things so that when we are at the point of rolling it out, when school starts, that we do a good media campaign about it, alerting people that, hey, this is what's going to happen. It's not something to just, you know, roll it out there and we go with it. And really sit down and try to figure out any hurdles that we might need to accomplish. We're looking to hopefully start this in September of next school year. Any questions or any other comments?
Mm-hmm. I think that'll be good.
I do too. I think it's great.
It's something I've wanted for a long, long time. I've been kind of vocal about it.
It's been very nice to have Lieutenant Embert help us out with this and work on that. That's the part that we were looking for. So he's been a great asset to us.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Embert.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Next. Okay. All right. Individual action items. First, we have the H&R report. No, she's not here. Sorry. Transportation. policy.
I know, more standing up.
So we have to do a motion on the HR report.
Okay.
Well, I make a motion that we accept the HR report as presented in closed session.
Second.
They have a motion, it's been seconded. Do I have any questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it. Next we'll have
Transportation report.
The transportation report by, don't say it, by who?
Mr. Pender's gonna, he presents it.
Okay, a motion for the transportation report, I'm sorry.
Yes, we have three buses that are, their life expectancy is done. And one also had a small fire on it that we're looking to replace. They would be Joyce Butler, Laura Lai Kinneman, and Goldie Singh. Joyce Butler and Goldie Singh will be for next school year, and Laura Lai Kinneman would be for this year due to the electrical fire she had.
Okay. Can I get a motion accepting the?
I make a motion to purchase the three new buses as well as the PVAs that go with them for Laura Lai Kinneman, Joyce Butler, and Goldie Singh.
Can I second?
I second the motion.
We have a motion that's been seconded. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Oh, I'm sorry. Any comments or questions? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. And next, we'll move to the policy third reading for, and third and final reading for the students and parent and guardian grievance process, Mr. Farley. Cell phone policy.
I believe, Mr. Farley, that we have not had any public comment as it relates to those two.
So we'll move to the military policy.
That was amended. We had taken that out. So it would be to approve those two policies.
Alrighty, can I have a motion to approve those two policies, the cell phone policy and the student and parent guardian grievance process?
Shouldn't that be done separately?
Yeah, you can do them together.
Do them together.
Unless you want them separate.
I would like them separately.
Okay. Alrighty, can I have a motion for the cell phone policy?
Move that we approve the cell phone policy.
A second?
Second.
Any questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
Okay. Military policy?
No, that's off the table.
Okay.
Now you have to do the student and parent guardian's grievance process.
Okay, you want them separate, I'm sorry. Okay, next we have the a motion to approve the parent grievance process. Can I get a motion?
I make a motion to accept the student or parent guardian grievance process.
Second.
We have a motion that's been seconded. Any questions or comments in reference to that motion? Hearing none, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Alrighty. Now we'll move down to the policy for the graduation, or for the reading. Second reading policy for the graduation exercise.
And I believe, and I'll check with Ms. Pauls, but we have not received any public comment as it relates to the graduation exercises policy for the second read.
All right, so can I have a motion that we accept?
Move that we move the graduation exercise policy for out for a third read.
Mm-hmm. Can I get a second?
Second.
Have a motion and second. Any questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it. And the interim superintendent's report by Mr. Gregory Paduski.
So we There hasn't been much time between the last time that we had met as a board, but there's a couple things I want to draw to your attention. And number one, that we have been meeting, all the executive staff have been meeting since our last board meeting with all of our principals. We finished that up in our budgeting process. So those are some long days, but those are very important to understand those needs. And the other thing is that my wife and I had a great opportunity right before the holiday to visit the St. Andrew's Preschool Christmas Program with Ms. DiMaggio up at Southersville area, and it was wonderful to see the little ones, and I think it was the little child that was dressed as a sheep, I think, was the one that that my wife really liked, and I think it was the horse as well, or the cow, but it was precious. It was precious. So,
and our families made all those costumes,
and they did.
Yes.
And it was a well attended event. But so,
although is short preschool related to our school system in any way,
we have children that are in dual enrollment. We have children that attend Southersville Elementary School preschool that also attend St. Andrew's Chapel preschool.
Okay.
If they go in the morning to SES, they attend with us in the afternoon, and if they attend in the afternoon, they come to us in the morning. We have currently seven children at dual enrollment.
Okay, but we don't have any financial connection with that preschool at all. Okay, thank you.
Just a community event.
Yeah. Future QACPS children.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's a lot of support, huh? Mm-hmm. Alrighty, so
9.02.
We have the curriculum and instruction report by our sister's assistant superintendent, Ms. Janet Pauls.
Sister.
Sister.
She is my sister. You're now sisters.
I'm sleepy.
So good evening. The CNI team has been busy, as you can see. It amazes me each month when the report is compiled how much has really been done. But just to highlight a few things, Tina Thomas was responsible for leading us through a CTE audit visit, and it went extremely well. We had members from the community and our partners and MSDE, and they were extremely pleased with the results of our CTE program. Also, Christina Schindler has been responsible for a Speak Up survey, which really assessed our families on digital learning and the use of technology. And Sutlersville Middle School ranked within the top five in the nation for completion of that survey.
Oh,
really? Kim Umberger has had a very successful fall partnership for youth session in all of the schools, and it closed out, but the feedback was extremely positive and it went very well. And earlier we talked about the professional development that's been offered by Campbell and Jones to all of our schools, and we've heard nothing but positive feedback from that professional development. So we're excited to see the results. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Pauls. Next.
One question. Are we making plans for future professional development on the computers similar to what we've had in the past? Because I've gotten a lot of feedback from the teachers that they really like that and want to keep that program going, the writing digital wave, which we do in the summer period.
Mm-hmm.
I know we're looking at changing some of the professional development, but are we the thing that Christina had started on, are we going to be doing more of that the same? Because that's really important to the curriculum.
Yeah, I think in the past it's been the end of the year work
that's
day.
Right.
And I don't know what that's going to look like this year. Because of the change in the last day, and the teacher's last day is work day is pretty much the last day of school. So we'll have to look at coming up with some creative ways of making sure that it's continued.
Okay.
In fact, a lot of the feedback that we got from teachers is really at the beginning of the year. And now that we've got that upfront professional development, that might be something as a kickoff at the beginning that we start with everybody and then move into. So we're certainly going to look at,
I just don't want it to go away because it's very valuable.
Yeah, we don't either.
And we spend a lot of money on those computers. And
oh, sure. And I think it's continuing the deepening of how we're using the technology, not just to use the technology, mm-hmm. because kids can be engaged, but are they engaged in the academic standards that they need to master at that particular grade level? So we're going to continue to you know, look at how we can engage teachers in professional learning in that way. And not only teachers, but through that, that was also administrative staff. I mean, it was right. It was a lot of folks.
And what I liked about it was it also brought in the train-the-trainer concept at the schools and also brought in the high school kids. And mm-hmm. it was just a mm-hmm. fabulous program for those 2 years. And I just wanted to encourage it to continue because it's vital to the curriculum and instruction of the students.
And I wanted to mention also that Josh Combs was responsible for supporting the Speak Up survey as well because of his role. He's just not in my camp, so I often forget him, but we work together very well, and so he is responsible for that as well.
That's nice of him. Mm-hmm. Well, our expenditure report and chief financial officer is out. Ms. Rockenbacher.
She is. Ms. Landgraf is sick this evening, but if there are any questions that you have, please mm-hmm. feel free to email those to me, and I'll make sure that Ms. Landgraf responds. If there are any questions on, and I think on that you'll see that we've changed that. I think the board has appreciated her summary mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. of expenditures, with maybe kind of broken that down a little bit better. Yes. Okay.
Alrighty, and our upcoming meetings and events.
We have 10, which is the second citizen participation.
Okay. Is there any citizen participation or public comment? Speak now. Alrighty. Upcoming meetings and events, January the 18th, 2017, will be our budget workshop, our budget work session at 11 o'clock a.m. to 2 o'clock p.m. Also, January the 23rd, 2017, will be our board retreat, 9 o'clock a.m. to 3 o'clock p.m. I think place will still be discussed.
We are, and I think Ms. Wright and I are, we think it's going to be at the county housing building right out by the high school, the new building. They have a great facility there that they've allowed us to use that back room, which is a great space to be able to have our retreat.
Okay, sounds good. January the 25th, we'll have another budget work session at 11 o'clock a.m. to 2 o'clock p.m. And now I need a motion to adjourn the meeting.
So moved.
Need a second?
Second.
Motion is second. Any comments or concerns? Hearing none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. The ayes have it. Meeting is adjourned. Let me hit my thing.
She's wanted to do that all night.